copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 264 regarding a robbery at the Federal Reserve Bank. Assist the officers. That's all. Road.
Taken nowadays to safeguard the food you eat. Rio Grande is just as particular about the health of your automobile. I believe you'll agree that we'd be very foolish indeed if, after all the painstaking care and engineering genius employed in making this pure 100% paraben-based motor oil, we sold it in bulk, thus allowing dust and grit to get into it, sent into your motor, and eventually playing havoc with its delicate mechanism. No real lube must reach the crankcase of your motor as pure, clean, strong, and positively undiluted as when it leaves the refinery. And it does, thanks to the hermetically sealed tamper-proof can in which this great lubricant is exclusively sold. Because of this precaution, we can guarantee that real lube does not, cannot break down under the most intense heat of your motor at its highest speed. That real lube, smooth, rapid flow to every part of your motor cannot be slowed up even by zero weather. Everyone should have this maximum all-weather protection that costs only a quarter a quart. Get it tomorrow morning when you drive in for that tank full of Rio Grande Cracks, the gasoline that meets every emergency with Rio police car performance. Tonight came from the confidential files of the Los Angeles Police Department. Therefore, Chief of Police Davidson has asked Captain Russell Smith of the robbery detail to open our program.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Occasionally, the work of the law enforcement officer becomes very amusing in retrospect. Tonight's story is such a case. Although the work at the time was most serious, and looking back on it, the officers concerned were more amused than startled by the bizarre outcome. In spite of the fact that a crime had been committed, the circumstances were such that it partook of the nature of burlesque. The seeming unintelligence of the criminal turned out to be, however, a very carefully assumed condition. But it was a condition that made the work of the officers extremely hard. I will tell you more of the story at the end of the program.
At 8:10 on the night of Friday, November 4th, 1926, three members of the Los Angeles Police Department, Lieutenant Hawtrey, and Detectives Tom O'Brien and Bud Curtis, were being ushered into an office of a bank at 2nd and Spring Street.
Mrs. Smith, is your gentleman a policeman? A powerful anxious to see you all.
Oh, good evening, gentlemen. I'm sorry I couldn't admit you sick. I've got a problem on my hands. The books just won't balance.
Are you the manager of this branch, Frank?
Oh, dear, no. I wouldn't think of exciting a manager over such a small matter. You see, there's only $74,000 missing.
Only $74,000 stolen, and there's nothing to get excited about.
Now, please don't misunderstand me. I didn't say it was stolen. We just can't find it. And I've been checking the books all day to see if there had been a counting error. But I can't find that either.
Do you mind if I ask what you called the police for if you didn't think it had been stolen?
But the idea of anyone stealing from the Federal Reserve Bank is preposterous. I called you because I just didn't know what else to do.
Oh, dear. Bud.
Yeah?
Go bring that colored janitor back here.
All right.
Now, look, Mr. Smith. You had $74,000. Now you don't have it. Let's play a little game and pretend it was stolen.
Well, this is really very serious. But I don't see how it could possibly have been
stolen. Why don't you just tell us all about it, eh? We're not bookkeepers, but we can put two and two together, and lots of times we get the right answer.
Well, yesterday at closing time, we checked $370,000 in gold certificates into the vault clerk.
$370,000.
There was one bundle of $74,000 that had been set aside as a deemed damaged currency.
Yeah.
But it was put on the truck and wheeled into the vault with the rest of the money. When the truck was brought out this morning, it wasn't there.
I see.
It's the strangest thing. I've been checking and checking all the livelong day, and I'm just stumped.
You're stumped? We're given a time to get halfway across the country, and I suppose you'll think we're inefficient if we don't go lay our hands right on the crook.
Crook? How can you say such a thing?
Now, let's get down to business. How many vault clerks were there?
Two. I thought you might want to talk to them. I'll go get you there.
What do you make of it, Tom?
It's an inside job. It's got to be. But I almost wish it wasn't, because it's going to be plenty tough.
Yeah, all these federal places seem to think an employee would be struck dead if he looked cross-eyed at a dollar bill.
Here's the ground with Tom.
You stick around, Wes. We want to talk to you.
Yeah,
sir. This is a vault clerk. They've all been here over 10 years.
That's from my own spot.
What's your name?
John Reynolds. And this is Frank Parsons.
Mm-hmm.
He came to my home for dinner and stayed all evening. And I drove him to his home. And I drove back to my home. We didn't know anything about the shortage until we came to work this morning.
This morning?
We'll check up on that later. Who else had access to the vault?
Nobody.
Who might have gotten in there after you took the truck with the money on it in there?
No one came in there. We locked the vault shortly after 4:30 and left.
Who saw you take the truck in there?
Any number of employees. I couldn't say who they were.
Did anyone come near the truck as you were wheeling it in?
No. Why should they?
Why should they? Listen, mister, I'm asking
you. You don't understand. All of our people are completely trustworthy. They have to have the best of recommendations before we hire them.
Yeah, we know all about that, but what have you got this janitor here for?
Well, he was probably nearest to the truck. He was sweeping the floor. So I asked him to stay tonight until you got here.
All right. Did he come near the truck or didn't he?
No. No one came near it.
Okay, that's the way it is. Now, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. You two vault clerks are the last ones who saw that bundle of money. I'm going to give you just 3 minutes to think of some tangible clue to its disappearance. If you can't tell me more than you have, I'm going to take you in.
Oh, but you can't do that.
I can't find the crook from what you told me either, but I'll do it just the same.
Hey, where are you going?
You all mean me, sir?
Yes, you.
I've got some cleaning up to do.
Well, you stay right here. We've got some cleaning up to do, too.
Yeah, I
I hope for your sake you've done some fast thinking. Now you're ready to talk.
Well, I don't like to say anything that might sound as though we were putting the blame on somebody else to protect ourselves.
Don't worry about that, Angle. Just spill it.
Well, I was talking to one of the guards today, and he said he saw Wes, the janitor here, taking his overalls home with him. They were rolled up in a bundle.
Is that right, Wes?
Yeah.
Oh, don't tell me now. Let me guess. You were taking them home to have them washed, weren't you?
You'll have to give us something better than that, boy. You can see he has clean overalls on.
And you said yourself he didn't come near the truck. The only other thing I can tell you is Wes told the guard he was quitting his job Monday.
Well, now that is something.
Say, with $74,000, he'd either tell his feet to get going or be smart enough to stay around for a few months. He wouldn't quit on Monday.
Why are you quitting on Monday, Wes? Did you come into an inheritance?
Come into a what?
Why are you leaving this job? Have you got another one?
Yeah.
Where are you going to work?
Let me see. I don't exactly know.
I see. You mean you're going to work for someone else, but you haven't decided who it's going to be yet, huh?
I can't figure things out powerful like that.
Well, he's not what you might call brilliant, but he seems to be the highest recommendation. I looked up his application today. I can tell you anything you want to know about him.
Including the fact that he didn't take the dough.
Is he married?
Married?
I don't suppose it would do any good to ask Wes. He probably wouldn't know offhand.
Well, of course, I remember. He's married and lives at the Evening Star Apartments on Central Avenue.
Evening Star Apartments. I'll tell you what we'll do, Mr. West. Let you and I take a little ride out to your house. I want to meet the family and all that sort of thing.
Uh-huh.
Sure. We'll just take pot luck.
I don't know how you all could do that. And my wife, she's awful fussy about who I bring around. But is she out tonight anyhow?
Oh, that's all right. I'll even help you call in the window. She has you locked up. Let's go.
But Miss Officer, she ain't I ain't got a wife.
Why, Mr. West, do you mean an employee has so misrepresented his status?
And in the Evening Star apartment?
Well, I don't live out there. I just said I had a wife because I thought I'd have more chance of getting a job if I had a wife. You think I'll be more responsible man?
Well, I think you're a responsible man, West. So we're going for a little ride. Just because I think you're responsible for $74,000.
Sure.
Now, look, West. We'll be at your house in a few minutes. We'll get the money and everything will be cleared up except one thing. Why did you steal it?
I don't know, dog. I didn't steal nothing, no.
Listen, West, we know how you did it. You're sweeping the floor as the truck went by. The first one looking at the package off the truck, you wrapped it up in your overalls and brought it home. Now, why'd you steal it?
I wouldn't steal nothing, no. I ain't that kind of a fellow.
What does your wife think about you having all that money?
She don't think nothing about anything, because I ain't got a wife.
Does she know you haven't got a wife?
Place ought to be in this block, Parker.
Yeah, it's quite a neighborhood, isn't it?
Hey, what are you stopping here for?
It's a vacant lot.
What? Hey, are you sure this is the place?
This is the address he gave us.
All right, now come on, Mr. West. Just tell us where you really live. We have all evening and lots of gasoline.
Well, I don't live no place here. I just sleep in empty houses and places like that.
Oh, come on, let's lock him up and find out where he lives tomorrow. This is getting an op.
I'm going to get this cleared up tonight. Now, for the last time, West, where do you live?
A place on 16th Street. I can't remember the number. I'll tell you all when we get there, though.
Let's go, officer. We got another clue. What's the clue?
Hey, this looks like an empty house.
Of course it's an empty house.
Mr. West lives here.
Well, I'll be.
Listen, West. I'm getting sick and tired of your stalling. It isn't going to get you any place.
It's getting us someplace. All over Los Angeles.
Now, are you going to tell us where you live or aren't you?
Well, I move a powerful lot. You all got me so excited. I'm all mixed up.
Oh, you shouldn't drive so fast, Hawthorne. You've got Mr. West all excited.
Well, let everybody be real calm. Try to think of something soothing, West, like a piece of watermelon.
Yeah.
Now, look, where do you live?
Oh, reckon it's over yonder on 24th Street.
You reckon that's really the place?
Well, hard to starve it, Hawthorne. We got another reckoning.
But try as he would, or wouldn't, West could not remember exactly where he lived. He led the officers all over the southwestern part of Los Angeles. Finally, their patience and gasoline exhausted, they came to a halt on a dusty side street.
Stop the motor, Arthur. Let's get up and set the lady. You stay in the car, West.
Yeah.
Rest that imagination of yours, because it's really going to get a working over.
Yeah.
Not sure, sir. We could have thrown him in a can. Personally, I'd like to make his memory wake up with a good poke in the snoo.
I mean, too, he's making monkeys out of it.
That's just what we're going to do.
Hey, wait a minute. It can't be. That is illegal.
Well, if he's right, it's not illegal. Much as I'd like to get around Mr. West on the technicality, it still would be against the law.
Oh, wait a minute, you guys. Of course we aren't really going to harm our forgetful friend, but there's no law that says we can't think about it, is there?
If there is, I've broken a study.
There's no law that says we can't speak our thoughts out loud to the prisoner, is there?
If there is, I've never heard of it.
Okay, what are we waiting for?
Boys, we've beaten around the bush with us long enough. Now it's our turn to do a bit of beating.
What's y'all getting at?
We're going to get at you, Sonny boy.
Huh?
Yeah, we tried being nice to him, but he don't seem to understand that sort of thing.
Oh, Hawthorne, get that rope out to come to the front seat.
Rope? What y'all messing around with rope for?
Oh, this is going to hurt us more than it does him.
Oh, I can't help it if my memory won't fumigate. I can't.
If he'd only tell us where he went last night.
Yeah, tell us where he put the money he stole.
Oh, I didn't steal no money. I just couldn't do nothing like that. I was a good boy.
All right. You're a good boy. Are you a good runner?
I was a very good... Is that a good boy? I was good. What you mean?
Did you notice how fast this car could go?
Yeah.
Do you think you could run that fast?
Y'all mean that fast with my own feet and legs?
You can fight on your hands if you want to.
No, sir. I couldn't do that no matter how scared I was.
Well, that's too bad, West. Too bad. Because you know what we're going to do?
No, sir.
I tied this rope around your waist. Then we're going to tie the end of the rope to the back of the car and start moving it.
That's just what we're going to do.
Wait, Lord, y'all can't do nothing like that now, huh?
Not if you tell us where that money is.
We'll get it sooner or later, anyhow.
But we'll get it tonight or else.
I didn't steal that money. I didn't steal nothing. My man and Pappy teach me not to steal.
And if there's anything left of you after we get done leading you around where all your friends can see you, we'll take you up to a nice, spooky graveyard and tie you to a gravestone.
And at 12 o'clock, the ghosts come out of the grave. And what they do to a colored boy that can't run is nobody's business.
Oh, Lord. Is that Daniel from the lion's den, the Hebrew children from the fire furnace? You gotta get me out of this mess.
No place for that idea. What do we do now?
Let him sit in the car and calm down. Come on over here where they can't hear us.
Yeah. See, you guys almost had me too. I feel sorry for the poor little one.
Yeah?
No, something's good. I don't know if I raise the balloon.
After the runaround he's been giving us? No, we're just using the wrong topic. He did a couple of things that gave me an idea, though. Let's try again. Follow my cue.
Why not? We can't get any less out of him.
Listen, West, my boy.
Yeah.
You know we wouldn't really have done any of those things to you, now, don't you?
Yes, I know.
Why, we wouldn't think of harming a nice fellow like you.
Of course not, West. We like you. And what's more, we believe you.
Sure.
An honest fellow like you wouldn't think of stealing.
No.
You must have a very fine nanny and puppy.
Yes, I will.
Where are they?
They're in Alabama.
Alabama. And they wouldn't like it if you stole anything, would they?
No, sir.
It'd make them very unhappy if they heard you'd stolen anything, I wouldn't.
Yeah, sir. They'd all feel powerfully bad.
Well, of course, we know you didn't steal anything, but everybody doesn't know what a fine, honest boy you are. Now, the news is going to get around that you're accused of stealing that money.
Huh?
And then what will your mammy and pappy think?
And how will they see? Won't they be ashamed of
it? We'll just about bust them all up.
They're fine people, aren't they?
Yeah.
Now, the point is, Wes, we know that you just borrowed the money or took it home for safekeeping. But if your mammy and pappy heard about it, they might think you stole it. And it would just break their hearts.
Mm. Now, where did you put the money?
Well, y'all better come on down to my house and get it. I'll live a few doors down the street here.
By an amazing coincidence, the officers had parked just a few doors from where Wes actually lived with his wife. The prisoner calmly handed over the package of money and was rushed back to the Federal Reserve Bank, where more problems of a more puzzling nature awaited the officer.
Well, Mr. Smith, there's the money. Money that no completely trustworthy employee would think of stealing.
Well, Wes, I am terribly disappointed in you.
Look, if you don't mind, I'd like to finish this case up and forget about it. So if you'll just count the money.
Yes, of course. I guess you must be tired. You've no idea how tired, Mr. Smith. It doesn't look as though it's even been opened.
Oh, yes.
Yes, it has here in one corner.
Any of it missing?
Let's see. It was in $1,000 bundles. Yes, there's some gone. I'll tell you how much in a minute.
Oh, are we going to have to start all over again?
All right, Wes. Where's the rest of the money you took?
I didn't take no money. Honest, I did.
If you say that just once again, I'll... Oh, what's the use?
Come on, Wes. It won't do any good to hold out on us now.
I ain't holding out on y'all. I'll give you all the money back. Y'all think I'd keep just a little bit of money when I could have had all of it? Most $5,000, I guess.
$5,000? Is $5,000 as high as you can count, Wes?
Well, it didn't do no count.
It's just $2,100 short, gentlemen.
$2,100, huh? Okay, let's start all over again.
Why did you keep that little bitty money?
Where did you put it?
What did you do with it? Think of the trouble you're causing.
Think of it. Dream of it. And think of your mammy and pet.
Now, listen here. Let me tell you all something.
There were 21 $100 bills.
Why did you have to?
I have
broken a spell.
If anybody says start over.
Hey,
wait a minute. Wait a minute. Hold everything.
Look at that. I got a little bit of little in this pocket.
Here, give it to me. 7, 9, 10.
$10?
No, just 10 single dollars.
And a little bit here in this your pocket.
Yeah, let me count this. Maybe I'll be lucky. 10, 15, 20.
And a little bit in this your pocket.
Let me try my luck. Maybe I'll hit the jackpot. 10, 12, 14, 15. That makes $45 altogether. At this rate, we'll be here all night if his pockets hold out.
The suspense of this thing is driving me nuts. Come on, Wes. Come on. Where's the rest of it?
That's all.
That's all. The beautiful simplicity of it stuns me.
Wait. Maybe if I go through his pockets, we'll have more luck. Hold still, David.
Don't know why we didn't do that before.
Oh, $45 wouldn't prove anything. It might be his money.
Well, Miss Alvin, I did take one bill out that there package here. Oh, 50. And I spent 5 hours looking clothes. But, I'll give that back to you if you want me to.
What? Do you mean to say you're actually admitting that you stole $5?
Oh, no, sir. I didn't steal nothing, no.
And you asked for it.
Uh-oh. What's this? A sales receipt for a Durant automobile dated yesterday. $300 made out to West.
So, you sold an automobile for $300 yesterday?
Yeah, the old car. I've been riding around.
That explains where he got the $45.
But he's already admitted he stole the $50 bill from the package.
I tell y'all, I didn't steal it.
In my entire career as a detective, I've never been so completely befuddled.
Well, I can't help wanting to believe it.
Hey, look, Bud, why don't you look through my pocket? Eh? Maybe I stole it.
If I may offer a suggestion.
Oh, no, you don't, Mr. Smith. No, we're mixed up enough as it is without any help along that line from you.
Are you sure you're looking in all these pockets, Bud?
Yeah, he's as clean as a whistle.
Wait a minute. I could get that.
Well, his overalls are clean anyway.
No, I mean I missed this pocket. It's a parking lot ticket.
So what?
Yeah, but it's dated today.
Today? And he sold his car yesterday. West, what have you got parked in there on this ticket?
Uh-huh.
You heard me. If you sold your car yesterday, what did you park in this lot today?
I can't remember exactly.
Oh, there goes his memory again.
Well, that's a sign we're on the track of something.
Yes, I think so. But if West thinks he's going to take us to every auto park in town before he remembers which one, I'm going crazy.
No chance. The address is on the ticket.
That's the first break we've had tonight. Let's go.
You gentlemen have overlooked the psychological angle.
Maybe we have, Mr. Smith. But you look at the psychology and we'll look for the money.
Come, come, Mr. West.
And this time we'll lead the way.
Yeah, Arthur.
Are you sure this is the place, Bud?
Yeah, this is the place, all right. I knew this would be a blank. We found it too easy.
It sure is deserted.
Look, West. If you sold your car yesterday, what did you park in here today?
I reckon I parked the car in here.
You parked the car in here. It isn't here now. Whose car was it?
Well, let me see. I can't remember.
For crying out loud, will you stop talking like
that? Wait a minute. What's that way back there in the corner, Bud?
I don't know. It's so dark, I can't see a thing.
Yeah, I think that is a car. Let's go back to see.
Yeah, it's a car, all right. And it's a brand new one.
Sure is new. It looks like a Chrysler.
Yep.
Well, we might as well save that step.
It's funny anyone would leave a car like this in here after the lot had closed. I mean, new.
See what name it's registered under.
Hasn't got a license on it.
No license.
You had the same idea I had.
Listen, Wes, did you buy an automobile today?
Yes.
You did, huh? Well, now, do you?
Why didn't you tell us so?
Y'all didn't ask me.
How much does a car like this cost?
Well, at a guess, I'd say between $2,300 and $2,400.
That's it. If it was $2,350, he'd get $300 for his old Durant. That would make it $2,050. He had almost $50 in his pocket.
Making it $2,100, the exact amount that's missing.
All right. Now, Wes, look. You admit you bought this car, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, in the face of this, you certainly aren't going to stick to your story that you didn't steal the money, are you?
What do y'all mean?
You just still say you didn't steal the money?
Yeah.
Well, who did steal it then?
Nobody didn't steal nothing. Wouldn't do nothing like that, no.
For the last time. Now, listen, Wes. We've been nice to you, haven't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. They've let you leave us all around town when we could have put you right in jail and found out these things later. You appreciate that, don't you?
Yeah.
And all we've done is ask you little bitsy questions. Now, look, if you'll just tell us the truth, we'll try to see that you get off very easily. Won't that be nice?
Yeah.
Then, if you're telling the truth and you didn't steal it, who did steal it?
Who
was working with you?
Who are you trying to protect?
Did somebody steal it for you?
No, it was stolen.
Somebody in the bank stole it.
You stole it and you know you did. Come on, you stole it, didn't you?
Come on.
I didn't steal nothing, no how.
Once again to the bank trudged the disgruntled detective. Certain they had solved the crime, but quite uncertain about the circumstances surrounding it and the criminal.
Well, Mr. Smith, they found the missing $2,100.
Oh, good. I'm so glad. Do you have it with you?
No, Mr. Smith. We didn't have the keys to it.
The keys to it? What do you mean?
We mean your $2,100 has been changed into a Chrysler automobile.
Mr. West did it with his magic wand.
He must have, because he didn't steal it. He says he didn't.
Well, this is terrible, terrible.
Yes, it's awful, isn't it?
Why did you steal that money, West?
I didn't steal no money, no, Mr. Smith.
There you are, Mr. Smith. A perfect example of a careful caretaker. You see, he was just going to take care of it for you.
Gentlemen, I still think you're overlooking the psychological angle of the case. Mm-hmm.
Maybe we are overlooking the psychological angle of this case, but we'll save that angle for the judge to look at.
The judge? What are y'all talking about a judge?
We're talking about the judge. We're going to try to persuade you didn't steal that money.
Mrs. Smith, does they all mean they're going to put me in jail?
I'm afraid they do, Wes. I'd like to believe you, but the evidence is pretty much against you.
What's against me?
It looks like you stole that package. Otherwise, how could it have gotten to your house?
Oh, I'm just doing my job as janitor and caretaker.
Just doing his job as janitor and caretaker. Wait a minute. Wait just a minute. What do you mean, Rick?
Oh, I always take home the trash and stuff and sweep up the floor. Mrs. Smith, you know that.
Yes, I know that, Rick.
And when I get the job here, the man, he says it's $15 a week, and what I found?
Found? Wait a minute. What's the story?
Would it have been possible for that package to be knocked against the wall as the truck was being wheeled into the vault?
Quite possible.
And would it be possible, as it was knocked off, to have fallen onto the floor?
That's the psychological angle, boys. West didn't steal it.
No, I didn't steal nothing, no. I was going up, found that package on the floor. And it says I can keep everything I found on the floor.
In just a moment, Captain Smith will conclude our program. In the meantime, friends, whenever you look at the gauges on your instrument panel, think of Rio Grande's great combination of protection and power. For the safest and surest protection that money can buy for your motor, Rio Lube Motor Oil. For maximum power at minimum cost, Rio Grande Crack, the police car performance gasoline. And now, Captain Smith.
West was tried in the Superior Court, but he stuck to his story. The arresting officers felt that they had resorted to methods which, in their opinion, might be construed as intimidating. For that reason, they refused to appear against West. He was found guilty, however, and sentenced to a year in the county jail.
Thank you, Captain Smith.
Attention all cars. Cancellation broadcast 264 regarding a robbery. Suspecting a case sentence of term in the county jail. That's all. Rose.
This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsay, bidding you good night for Rio Grande.
At this time, Rio Grande will present The Case of the Green Sedan. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.